Everyone, on behalf of IHL Refractories, formerly known as IHL Exports Limited, I warmly welcome you all to the earnings call of quarter 3 and 9 months FY18 financial results of our company. I have with me today Mr. Prateek of SGA, our investor relations advisors. I hope you have got a chance to go through the investor presentation which is uploaded on the stock exchange and our website. Giving a small brief on the industry update, on the global front, the steel inflations are expected to increase up to 86% by FY20 from the current level of 77-78%. This increase in utilization rate will also lead to an increase in refractory demand, thereby benefiting global players like us. Indian market share in global steel production is expected to rise by 6% in 2017 to 7% by 2020. This is further aided by favorable policies enacted by the government, such as imposition of anti-dumping duties on various steel products, which shall be applicable till 2021 and 22. The budget for the current year, 2018-19, was also a very positive for our industry. The budget has a strong focus on infrastructure creation, including rural electrification, housing, and roads. With the increased spending in infrastructure of around 6 lakh crore, the sector is being pegged as a key growth driver. This will boost the manufacturing sector and also help create demand for steel and cement sector, which are primary consumer of refractories. Refractory manufacturing in India is likely to get a boost from rationalization of custom duty on refractory items. This has been done in the current budget. The custom duty on refractory items has been increased from 5% to 7.5% in the budget this year. With this, the effective basic customs duty on refractories have increased from 5.15% to 8.25%. thus meeting a long-standing demand of the industry. This will provide the much-needed impetus for growth in the coming financial years and future also. Strong global prices coupled with steel import restriction measures are likely to protect margin for the domestic steel manufacturers. Further, domestic steel players have also announced expanding their capacities, which will further boost the demand for refractories domestically. With the global steel industry expected to pick up and the domestic industry also looking very good, the refractory industry is expected to be in good shape going forward. I'm now giving you a brief on our financial performance of quarter 3 and 9 months ended FY18. On the IHL consolidated level, for the 9 months FY18, the total income stood at 610 crores, up by 8.8% year-on-year. EBITDA was 17.6 crores so with a margin of 12.5%. Goodwill, which was created on merger of two companies, we wrote off around 20 crores for this 9 months. PBT was 41 crores and cash profit was 69 crores. Standalone on IHL India standalone performance, the 9 months total income was 322 crores, up by around 20%. EBITDA was 52 crores, up by 30% with a margin of 16%. Goodwill again was written off in these books only, about 20 crores. PBT was recorded at 21 crores, showing a growth of 115% YOY with a PBT margin of 6.6%. Cash profit was 49.5 crores, YOY growth of about 33%. International business, EI Ceramics total income in the 9 months was $12.5 million with a EBITDA of $1.88 million and a margin of 15.1%, while PAT was 1.14 with a margin of 9.1%. Monocone, our UK subsidiary with its own group subsidiary companies, the 9 months total income was £18.94 million, representing a growth of 5.7%. EBITDA stood at GBP 1.45 million or at 7.7%, while PAT was about 1.02 with a PAT margin of 5.4%. Hoffman Ceramic was a bit down this 9 months, our German subsidiary. The total income was 7.34 million euro. It had a very nominal small loss of 0.16 million euro. The CapEx towards capacity increase, automation, efficiency enhancement is on track and will be completed in first quarter FY19, hopefully. So this is nutshell about the group and the industry. And I'll be happy to take any questions and answers.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone wishing to ask a question, may please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. We'll take the first question from the line of Udit Bokaria from Kathmandu. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for taking my question. So you were mentioning about the steel industry growth of India. So just wanted to understand, like, what is your view, like, is it the large integrated players that will be growing faster than the industry, or you see that the small steel players getting benefited from the budget and they will grow at a faster pace? And the second question is, sir, when you are speaking about the global steel demand growth, like, are there any particular countries in Southeast Asia where you believe that is expanding very fast and the steel demand will grow from there?
The first question, Indian steel industry, I think major growth will come from the integrated belts. Okay, so you must have seen all the expansion happening in SAIL, Tata Steel, JSW, and like, you know, those are nothing but integrated steel mills. Having said that, I would say that not mini mills, but mini mills, the medium steel sectors with electric arc furnace will also grow. Okay, but the major quantum will come from the integrated steel mills. Okay, and on the international front, Middle East segment is growing now at a faster pace than it was about a year back. The reason being the oil price, you must have seen the oil prices have gone from $30 to about $70. So they now have again come back to a good cash surplus situation. So like all the Middle East segment, there is a growth. I would say not only Middle East, take a bit wider area, take into account, you know, all the other neighboring things, they're growing. Iran will grow much faster than any other country in that segment. So all those areas, though the steel plants which were like either shelved or stopped or held for the time being, will again start reviving. Okay. So overall, I think overall the steel industry is poised. So this is the first time if you look at the 9 months steel figures from the World Steel Organization. I think all the countries have shown a positive steel growth, Y on Y. So this is a good sign, I would say.
Sir, and in our revenue mix, like how much is it coming from flow control devices and how much from advanced refractories in the domestic business?
You are talking of the terminologies which is usually used by Vesuvius.
Okay.
Vesuvius has a big flow control and a big advanced refractory. I would say we are not like that. But yes, if I am trying to use that same terminology, a major part of the business is flow control. But having said that, we also have a non-flow control refractory which does not fall under the advanced refractory also.
Okay.
In the Vesuvius terminology or parlance.
Okay. And sir, like, are there any, like, since the commodity prices which is used for refractories are increasing, right? So how are you negotiating with your customers and, like, how will it impact the gross margins for the refractory industry in general?
It's a continuous process. I think this is something which I cannot tell you offhand. It's a continuous process.
Thanks for taking my question, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, we would like to remind participants that you may press star and want to ask a question. The next question is from the line of Zain Iqbal, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity, sir. I have an open-ended question. I just wanted to know which are the key metrics, business metrics, that you track on an ongoing basis, which tells you about the condition of the business.
Pardon, can you come again? What exactly you
want? I just wanted to know the key business metrics or operational metrics which you track on an ongoing basis, which tells you the condition of the business. Like if you were to stay away for 1 year and you want to check how your business is doing, which key metrics would you track?
We supply consumables to refractory industry. We don't supply a capex plant. It is not that, you know, it's going to happen seasonally. So ours is a consumable product for the steel industry. So the only matrix which is applicable to us is the growth in the steel industry. So there is no way I can say that this 1 year I will stay away from this particular sector or that particular sector. The other key factor would definitely be the health of the particular steel plant. Okay, so depending upon that health of the steel plant, whether they are in a position to pay us back or not, that's the another key factor, which is so basically the growth in the steel industry and the health of a particular company. That's the two key factors which we normally look at.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is on the line of Amrita Vivek from iThought. Please go ahead.
Hi, my question is with regard to the shaped and unshaped products produced by your company. So if you look at the standalone numbers, it's about 88% of shape to 12% of unshaped in FY17. Now in FY16, the portion of unshaped was about 0.3%. So now this has gone up to about 12% in FY17. Not sure if this is solely attributed to the merger. My first question is, are there any plans to increase the share of unshaped refractories in the coming years? And two, I also wanted to understand the breakup of shaped and unshaped at the consolidated level. And my last question is with regard to the infrastructure. So just wanted to understand the possible extent of switchability between the two products, whether the same infrastructure can be used to produce the two products.
One and first and foremost question, you are, because this is the first balance sheet post-merger.
Okay.
So the March 16 figure, which is there on the printed balance sheet, which is available on the net, is not comparable with March 17 figures.
Hmm.
Okay. So March 16 figures, if we take the standalone a previous annual report, okay, and add the March 16 figures, which is the erstwhile IFGL exports figures, and eliminate the intercompany transactions by doing that related party schedule, if you look at it, you can see the sale purchase, you will come to a particular figure. Okay. So the shaped and unshaped figures in March 16 in the March 17 annual report is not comparable.
Okay.
Our matrix has not changed. In these 2 years, broadly, the matrix has not changed. Okay, that's number one question. Number two, on a globally, honestly speaking, we don't share these data on a wide basis. But you can come offline and come through SGA, and then we can sit down. What is the importance of this? Number three, this cannot be switched. The manufacturing facilities cannot be switched between the shaped and unshaped. We have enough capacities in both the segments, so I think switchability is not so easy, or in fact, it is not possible.
Okay.
And we have enough capacities in both the segments.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, we would like to remind participants that you may press star and want to ask a question. The next question is on the line of Britsha from Britsha and Associates. Please go ahead.
Hello. So thank you for the opportunity. So I have a couple of questions. First is, are there any write-off during this quarter?
Yes, we have a provision policy of receivables. So this is definitely it's a continuous process. And this quarter has been slightly higher than the normal.
So, sir, can you just throw some light regarding how much there is increase in the write-off in terms of percentage?
I don't have the percentage, but I think what we can do is I can give you these figures. Maybe you can talk to me after this call, or maybe we can fix up. But there is a strong our internal control procedure wherein if the outstandings are above a particular limit, we have to provide for it. So unfortunately, this quarter on a standalone basis has been a slightly higher write-off, and one of the reasons for the lower profit is one of that. But let me also tell you, as a rider, a big chunk of that write-off which we took in December 17 quarter, we have received this in current quarter. So
okay.
Possibly there will be a sharp reversal of those provisions in the current quarter also.
Okay. And sir, with respect to Hoffman, it has been a significant underperformer this year. So can you throw some light on
underperformance? There was one particular product group which was a highly profitable product group for us.
Okay.
That demand for that product group in this current 9 months was substantially lower. Number one. Number two, as it is, you know, you must have seen in the last few quarters, we have announced that we are going in for capex there for operational efficiency improvement and productivity improvement. This plant was pretty old plant. Obviously, the cost of production was slightly higher. The margins are very wafer thin margins, as it is for Hoffman. So this capex will get over by, say, I think latest by first quarter of FY19. And we'll see the operational efficiency improving there. We'll see a positive in fact, we are looking at a positive in the quarter four also. But definitely going forward, FY19 should be a better one. The product which I was mentioning, I think is showing a sign of improvement as far as offtake is concerned. So hopefully the next FY19, next financial year should be a better year. But yes, it is a bit of a concern as of now.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We'll take the next question from the line of Pratesh Cheda from Lucky Investment Managers. Please go ahead.
Sir, there's a few questions on the EBITDA performance on the nine-month basis. So if you see the standalone operation has growth and in EBITDA, and that entire EBITDA seems to have been eaten away by the decline in EBITDA on the international operations. So my first question is, on the standalone operations, is the EBITDA growth largely driven by IFGL export merger? Because I think that's where the capacities were. And what would be the color on EBITDA growth on standalone operations, you know, next year? And second, how do you, improve the EBITDAs on the international operations, or what are the drivers, and what could the EBITDAs look like on the international operations?
So there are too many questions into it. I would say some of the questions I would try to answer. On a standalone basis, the top line has grown by about 16%. Okay. So that is a good growth. If we take net of excise duty, those are not comparable, pre-GST and a post-GST. Net of excise duty sales has grown by 20%. Okay, EBITDA has grown by 30%. So you can imagine there is a slight improvement of EBITDA. Yes, you are right. The growth in IFGL export, the erstwhile IFGL export plant, which is the Kandla plant, has been quite good. So margins in Kandla plant are very good, number one. Number two, the product range which we make in Kandla, there has been a significant growth in the top line, so the margins are slightly higher. Number three, obviously, euro has favored us compared to the last financial year. Yeah, the euro has also favored. So you must have seen rupee has depreciated vis-a-vis euro. So that has also favored us in the first 9 months this financial year compared to the last 9 months, which is in fact a comparable figure. On the international front, I would say there have been some small issues. As I mentioned, Hoffman in my previous questions, I don't want to repeat it again. EI Ceramics has slightly marginally dropped because the first two quarters in the last financial year were slightly comparatively better, because the previous two quarters of the last financial year, to that there was a very less offtake. So suddenly the offtake increased in the first two quarters of the last financial year. We hope that the trend continues what we have done now. That company looks to be doing very well. Monocon is more the margins go high when we sell some equipment. So this year, overall, the equipment offtake has been slightly lower because steel plants had withheld all capex in the last one and a half years. So hopefully in the next financial year, FY19, the equipment sale would be good. And we are also doing some restructuring in that company. So the margins in that company should also do good. Overall, the currency situation is getting better now. So hopefully the currency effect in the first 9 months will be a positive sign in the first quarter and this up going forward. So this is a nutshell, things look at this way.
So just to clarify here, you foresee that international operation recovers the lost margin next year and international operations mirrors the volume growth of the respective territory?
Yes.
Okay. My second question on the IFGL export side, what kind of traction do you see next year?
There is no IFGL exports now. There is IFGL Refractories Limited now. It's a merged company. There's only one company, so we will not talk of two different. IFGL, we see a reasonable growth in coming quarters also.
Similar to what you have said.
We honestly try to avoid giving any kind of forward-looking statements, but I would say that we should be doing better compared to we had a low quarter three. We feel quarter four should be very good, okay, and hopefully we can continue with a similar kind of growth of FY17 and FY18 also.
So just one clarification, the standalone operation, how much of it is domestic business driven?
It's around the standalone operation, the domestic will be around anywhere, around 45% will be domestic and 55% will be exports, anywhere between 43 to 45%.
And are there any margin levers in domestic operations?
They are slightly different. The dynamics of the things are different. But if you look at overall logistics cost of transferring the material to from our warehouse to their warehouse, plus the commission agents, the selling agents, selling costs there are slightly higher. So margins would vary. But definitely the international margins are slightly better than the domestic margins.
My question was, can the margins rise? Are there any drivers to the current margin of 16% that you've reported? Are there any more drivers to that margin?
No specific drivers.
Okay.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhisar Jain from Centrum Broking. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Good morning, sir. Sir, the question is on the standalone business. So I think Q3 has been a subdued quarter wherein we have seen sequentially quite a large dip in the absolute EBITDA number despite the similar amount of top line. So almost a 8 crore dip. You mentioned, sir, in your comment, previously that there was some excess provisioning also which is sitting in the other expenses. Sir, can you quantify that amount and is there anything else also which has led to this drop and, you expect this to improve now going forward?
There are a few things. There's not only one thing which is there. The last question was on higher provision. Provision, I think, if I'm not wrong, I think anywhere between 2.5 to 3 crores is the excess provision which we have taken in the December quarter.
Okay.
And as I mentioned, possibly we'll have a reversal of some of these past provisions in quarter four. Okay.
Okay.
But on top of it, there was a very high raw material price increase in the last 6 months. And the last quarter, and of course this current quarter also, we'll see a very high raw material prices to be absorbed.
Right.
Price increase takes time. So the price increase did not happen so much in December quarter. Hopefully, there are few customers who have agreed for price increase, so we'll see some positive sign in the quarter four and coming months. So cumulatively, there were some quality issues in our plant, so we had to go for some sort of rationalizing our manufacturing processes. So 3-4 issues put the quarter profitability absolutely down. But I hope the quarter four, we should be doing pretty good.
Sure, sir. Understood.
Overall on a nine month basis, I think the profitability is much better than previous 9 months.
That's true, sir. That's true. Sure, sir. And sir, just on this point of the raw material price increase getting passed through, so is there a divergence in you be able to get the price passed through in domestic and export? Is one market better than the other by any chance?
See, for us, domestic market has a different ball game. Okay, domestic market, you are all talking in rupee terms. Okay.
Right.
When you import in rupee, you sell in rupee. Import in dollars and you sell in rupee. So the dynamics is different. So passing through happens only if the customer gives you a price increase.
Correct.
Okay. But fortunately and incidentally for us, rupee has weakened over the last few months. Okay. And our major sales is in euro. So we got some benefit out of that. You know, partially the price increase is getting offset against the rupee depreciation vis-a-vis euro, I would say. So basically, euro appreciating vis-a-vis dollar.
Mm-hmm.
That's the major thing which has happened. So obviously, the margins in compared to domestic in the last few months and maybe in the current quarter also, things have gone better in overseas compared to domestic, has improved due to the exchange rate fluctuations. But passing on is happening. The steel plants have now are in the process of giving the price increase to anyone, because for them availability of refractory is more important than a price increase.
Yes, actually, sir, I was just coming to this point because we have seen a slight divergence in the gross margin performance of your company and your competitor Orient Refractory, which is also servicing, largely the domestic mills to the extent of 70-75%, and that too smaller ones. So they were also, cautious on the raw material pricing increasing and the pass-through, but, they were mentioning that the pass-through has been signaled. So, but in their results, there has been a gross margin expansion in this quarter. Whereas we have seen a slight dip, but I'm not too concerned about sequential movements in specific companies, but from a directional point of view, you feel that Q4 we should be in a better position in the gross margin front, right?
Yes.
Okay understood.
Yeah.
Okay. And sir, from the expansion point of view which we are happening in both Kandla and Odisha, when do we expect the revenues to start flowing from those new lines?
I think it would be next financial year.
Sir, but any rough idea of whether it will be more H2 or will it start in H1 also?
Partially, it is a gradual process. Some of the equipment, in fact, like Kandla expansion, we are almost through.
Right.
Okay,
that's all.
So in this quarter, we will complete the expansion there in Kandla.
Sure.
We will start looking at the expansion getting used in the from first quarter itself. In fact, we will see something in the current quarter also. Raukala, we will see. In fact, we will start seeing in the H1 only.
Understood.
But how much the market takes, it has to be looked into. It all depends on the market scenario.
Surely, sir. Surely.
But I think we'll see some better results in Q4 and also going forward.
Understood, sir. Thank you so much, sir. That's all from my side and best of luck.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Kamal Sarda for his closing comments.
Thanks a lot. I think, gentlemen, we have had, gentlemen and ladies, we have had a good question and answer sessions, and I hope I've been able to answer most of your queries. Though we look forward to your participation in the subsequent quarters, if you have any further queries, either you may contact our investor relation advisors, that is Strategic Growth Advisors. Thank you all. Have a nice day.
Thank you.